So this talk is about the way how we can consider social processes and how we can model them as far as adaptivity is concerned. And that is a kind of discussion because in the social area, you can have adaptive social networks, for example. But in the neuroscience area, you can also model networks, but then there's still a bit more knowledge available. So therefore, in the contents that I will show here, you can see that I will use some inspiration from neuroscience. So we will do two disciplines actually today in the talk, the neuroscience to get an idea of what could be expected, and then in social science, what is already there and what is not there, because part of the talk will also be about what's not there, unfortunately. So this is the overview. I will talk about the self-modeling network ID. That's also called reified networks. I have a book, a 2020 book. This is in the last slide. If those can see the slides from the seminar page, you can find it there. And that's the general part. And then I will just talk about this adaptation application possibilities. So the idea is in network science, you consider networks as a kind of vehicle to describe things. And I'm also calling it network-oriented modeling, because you don't model networks, but you use models and networks as models for things in the reality processes. And in particular, you do that for different domains. So it's a kind of generic format, and you can apply it in many different disciplines, many different domains. So the basic characteristics that I consider is say connectivity characteristics. That's the connections between nodes. I also call the node states, because they have state values over time. And aggregation is a very important characteristic type of network as well. If you have multiple connections to one node, it is always the question how you should combine the impacts that these multiple connections have. And for that, you need an aggregation, a form of aggregation. It's a bit neglected in the literature, and often even just linear functions are used for it only. So then the third type of aspect is the timing. These are the speed factors that can be attached to every state, so that they can have their own timing. So just a bit of background. So Pearl, in his famous book on causality, also points at that usually there are just pictures of the connectivity of a network. But indeed, this aggregation, what he is expressing in these functions, Fi, that's also a very important part. And for the timing, for example, in neural networks, you just use a kind of uniform function, and then you have automatically the timing that comes with that function. And you have no tools to specify different speeds. So actually you assume some form of artifact as synchrony in your process, and you are not able to make kind of adaptation of this synchrony to a more asynchronous possibility, as you often see in real world situations, where not all processes are in the same synchronous way, of course. So therefore these types of characteristics are very convenient for applications. So let's consider the next part. So the idea is that we have these characteristics, and they define your network model. If you give values for these characteristics, then you define the network. Let me see. These are functions. These are just values for connection rates, and these are values for the speed factors. And there is a generic difference equation used, also implemented in the software environment, and it's automatically filled with these values. And that's this one. So then you have all these values have some place, some role in this difference equation, and then they can run. You can also write it as a differential equation, of course, like this. So this is the general format that is used for the networks here. So you can consider these things as all types of impacts on every node in your network. So your node has influence from other nodes, like this axis are from other nodes, the state values, but there's also influence from the connection weights, and also influence from the speed factor, and also influence from the way how you aggregate your different impacts from different sites. So that's how you can interpret that. And in this sense, you can also see here how this network structure characteristics entail the network dynamics. So that's a very interesting relation. If you want to know some properties of your network dynamics, in some cases you can just relate it directly to the network structure. And that's of course very interesting for analysis of your models. But the talk of today will not be on that. So for the aggregation, there is a library in the software environment, and there are standard functions, many standard functions for that, like these min and max functions that are often used in fuzzy modeling, linear functions that are often used in social networks, I should say. I don't know why, so, but it's a kind of custom there. You can also have geometric functions, like a geometric mean function, or Euclidean function like this. For example, for NS2, you can see that there's a quadratic type of function that sometimes is, can be used for vector addition or for error functions also. And there is often used artificial neural network functions like the logistic functions. But there are still more, there is more than 40 functions at the moment in this library. Notice that they are just formulas. They're very simple specification in general. They're not programs, not procedural things, just declarative formulas. You should keep that in mind, because that makes that the specification format for your network model is in fact a declarative format, not a kind of procedural format. This is one of my favorite movies. And maybe some of you have seen this earlier, but I like this movie a lot. So you see a network of sheep here. And they were able to form a cyclic structure. So this network, you can illustrate many things of this network. You can illustrate the idea of social contagion, because they have a contagion like this, and this according to these influences. But you can also see this as a way of adaptation, because they don't spend all their days running around in circles like this, of course. They came from another type of network structure, and suddenly they made this cyclic structure. So that's just a form of network adaptation. And in the dynamics of a network, you consider usually dynamics within the network or on the network, as some people say, and dynamics of a network. And both things are here. This is the dynamics within the network, the social contagion, and the change of the network is the dynamics of the network. And the two processes often occur together. And sometimes people call that co-evolution of the two types of processes. Well, this gives already, this also gives, by the way, an illustration of how a network can enter in a limit cycle process finally. So that's not automatically in an equilibrium, but it can just go on forever like this. So that's just a small idea of the network within dynamics and the network of dynamics. So the dynamics of the network and the dynamics within the network that play an important role. The talk of today will mostly be on the level of the dynamics of the network, because we want to discuss adaptivity. So that's the part that I will go now in more detail to. So what is an adaptive network? Well, it's a relatively simple idea. The network structure characteristics, like these omegas, these C's, the combination functions, or the speed factors, they change over time. That's the idea. So then we have connectivity adaptation, aggregation adaptation, and timing adaptation. So we want to address it in a bit systematic manner. And so maybe everybody knows connectivity adaptation, but these are also interesting. So that's the change in connection weights like you usually have in artificial neural networks. But here you can have changing combination functions or also parameters of combination functions. For example, in logistic functions, you have this thresholds, and that's usually in neuroscience, that's called excitability thresholds. They can also change over time. And there are neural principles, adaptation principles for neuroscience that describe that indeed, that they change. And timing adaptation means that you change speed factors, that you have a variable speed of processing. It's also, in some cases, a very interesting type of application. And you can also indeed see it in neuroscience. If I should say many examples that are real, that are already there and described in literature, I can find them much better in neuroscience than in social science. But I will come back to that later. So that's the reason why I often illustrate things from neuroscience. So let's consider now the idea of self-modeling network. And you can see that as an idea inspired by the notion of a self-modeling picture, like this picture here, that we use it as a metaphor. This is a kind of self-model for the whole picture. You see that the whole picture describes this, and this is a self-model for that. If whether or not it's a perfect self-model, maybe I should not talk about that. It's not that perfect, maybe, but at least you see the idea here. This is another case where you see this here is kind of self-model of the picture behind, but here also it's not so perfect because I don't see anymore what is behind now, so I cannot even verify whether it's a good self-model of what is there. I expect it is, but you don't see it. But that's the idea, that you have some small picture in a big picture, and that small picture describes part of the structure of the big picture. And so there is a kind of other problem. Let me see. If you do that, this is a better example. You see that this picture is here. But as soon as you add this picture, then the picture is not anymore along with that. Then you see two heads, for example, instead of one head. And there is no self-model of a picture of two heads. So then you can say this is a kind of first order self-model, and we need a form of second order self-model. So then you have a picture here of the picture of two pictures. But you see already that what happens here, now you have a picture of four heads and you don't have a self-model of that part. So then you need another one here with four, and you know, then you get something that is called infinite regress. So for practical purposes, you can never get a complete self-model in your picture, only parts. You should be willing to accept that. If you want to have a complete picture, then you can only do it in theoretical ways or in other ways. This is a Dutch famous, let me see, brand of chocolate and cacao. And they use this already since 1904 in their packages and advertising. So that's also a kind of famous, sometimes it's called the Droste effect even. So this is another case. You see also the infinite regress here again. These are just examples of the idea of self-modeling from the picture area. And you have it also in other areas, like in a theater play, that you have a theater within the play, or in a movie, you have a movie within the movie. So this, the notion of, in certain ways, self-reference has a broad application in wide areas of art as well. So what do we learn from this? So one thing is that you want to have at least some faithfulness of the self model. The self model should be a true copy of the original. And this is not so faithful. So therefore, we just consider that as not a good example. You should also have a persistence of the base picture. Well, this is not a good example because the base picture is disappearing behind the copy here. And you should accept that for practical cases, there will always be incompleteness. And if you want to have completeness for non-practical cases, if you are interested in that, it's still possible. You can do it as a mathematics from a mathematical side, that you have an infinite construction. You can do that, it's not so even so difficult. And, or you can, when you're not a mathematician but a magician, you can try to do some magical way of illusion of infinite recurrence. But of course, today we are just interested in the practical things, practically applicable things. So therefore, we accept that there will be some form of incompleteness. So how is it possible? How can you do that? Well, this for networks, and we can do that in a such a way that we have a way to model adaptive networks in a very easy way. And then it's even easier to put to iterate it over different orders of adaptivity. You don't need any procedural specification or programming code, and it covers dynamics within the modeling, but otherwise would be in the on the programming level outside the network modeling. So how do you do that? How can a network model specify or model itself? How can a network model itself? By adding a self model, like in the pictures, that's a subnetwork with states that represent some of the network structure characteristics. Not all, because we cannot have completeness, but we generally don't need it too. So you have some of the network structure characteristics. For example, you can have self model states for connectivity, for aggregation, or for timing. I'll show an example. For connectivity, is like you have connection rate and you want to make that adaptive, then you introduce a state for that, an extra state, W, just representing the value of this. That is a network state, so you extend your network by this state. If you have some combination function parameter like the excitability threshold of a logistic function, you add a state for that to your network. Or if you have a speed factor, you add a state for that. So this just adds network states, network nodes. These are the self-model states, and you can have the this is you can consider this as a way to add variables to your model for the parameters. This is a very general idea. If you want to have an adaptive dynamical model, usually you add variables for your parameters. But in this case, the special thing is that they are variables that are just network concepts. So they're not arbitrary variables, but they are just network nodes. And they are just participating in the network structure like network nodes. So that's the special thing here. So then you have the situation that you have this self model, where you have represented some of the network characteristics, and then you need to integrate them in your network, and then you need connectivity for them. So you need incoming connections that define the causal impacts on the self-model states, and also outgoing connections to effectuate the results, say, to really do the adaptation. So that it works really as adaptation. And there is also aggregation needed. So these self-model states, they need their own aggregation function or combination function. And exactly that function, remember the list I gave, they're just declarative mathematical descriptions, values related to values, that specify the adaptation principle. So an adaptation principle is specified also partly by this input that I used, but mainly by this combination function. So that's a different type of specification than just pseudocode or an algorithm or even Python code or whatever. So that's the declarative way of specifying adaptation principles. And for timing, you also need an adaptation speed to the speed factor of a self-model state is actually the speed of the adaptation. So that's normally called adaptation speed or, for example, learning rate. So this is a way to easily have learning with variable learning rates, learning speeds. So that's the this is the way how you embed your self model within the whole network, because these connections, they relate to the other states of the network. I will give an example soon of it. So first I want to focus a bit on some inspiration that can be found in neuroscience, plasticity and metaplasticity. They are two famous concepts in neuroscience. And the plasticity, that's, for example, by these authors from neuroscience, describing changes in two different types of two different, they can be the synapses. Of course, that's very well known also in AI, because many of the learning things, they learn just the connections in networks, in the neural networks. But you can also have modification in intrinsic properties of the neurons. For example, this excitability threshold of a neuron. That is one of the things that that is also, from neuroscience perspective, a well-known type of adaptivity. It falls all under the plasticity label. But you have also other things, like this principle, adaptation accelerates with increasing stimulus exposure. That's also by authors from neuroscience, or from Karsia, also from neuroscience, high stress levels slow down or block adaptation. Now, if you look at this, they are not just normal adaptation principles, they are actually adaptation of adaptation. So the acceleration of the adaptation. So that's what in the neuroscience literature is called metaplasticity. And one of the main issues in this talk is that such a notion like metaplasticity is lacking in social science, and we better can work more on that to add it to neuroscience as well. I will come back to that later. So these are just examples of adaptation principles of different levels. And let me show, this is, for example, how you can define Hebbian learning. And that is the idea that you have a base network, and we concentrate on this connection. We consider Hebbian learning for the connection from X to Y, and that's represented by this self-model state. So we draw that in different planes to make the distinction between the base level and the adaptation level. And then you need connections. And one principle that is often formulated for Hebbian learning is neurons that fire together wire together. So that's you need then to see whether these activation levels are at the same time high. So therefore you need input incoming connections to this self-model state. And the wiring together is then the part that affects it. So the strength of this connection, right, represented by the W, is used in the activation of Y, because there it comes in, there is this effect of the connection rate. So then you have a link there. So this is the way how you embed your self model within the whole network. You see it's connected to the network that was already there. So that's a specific type, is a connectivity self model, because it's about connections that are modeled here in the self model. So now let's consider this other type of adaptation principle. This is for it falls under the metaplasticity. This is second order type of adaptation principle, while the other ones are called first order. So these are a number of them from the literature, from neuroscience. So I already have shown them briefly earlier. So let's consider that now in a picture form. So we already have this learning situation with this self model for the learning, the heavy learning. And now we add the self model state for the speed of the learning. This represents the speed factor of this state here. And it's influenced by the activation of both neurons here, both states. Actually, we often use these models for mental processes. Then you can consider these more as mental states and not as neural states. But you can apply it at any level you want. So these are things that you use here to stimulate that this age becomes higher as soon as you get more activation here. So that increases the level here, and then you have the downward, that's the exposure accelerates idea. Then the downward is the accelerates itself. So then it really makes the speed higher that is used in this processing for this link, for this node. So that's the way how you can easily build these network models for adaptation on top of each other and then have multiple orders of adaptations. Let me see. This is an example where you have these different elements integrated in one model. So this is a very simple base level, but still a bit relevant in sense of applications. So this is a stressful stimulus, the sensory state, right? You see something, or you hear, or you notice something stressful. You build a representation of it in your mind or in your brain. And then that automatically triggers some stress response, some stress emotion. And that's the preparation for it. And that from that you get a stressful feeling. That's the feeling state here. Now, fortunately, we have regulation mechanisms for emotions, and they are very important. If they don't work well, then you get all kinds of mental and even non-mental disorders. So better keep your emotion regulation mechanisms well maintained. So that does not always happen. Sometimes this is a control state for that's usually seen as part of the prefrontal cortex. And this is more like amygdala, for example, or other places in the brain. And usually this link, this is by the way, a therapy state that can be added, but that's the second part. But usually this connection is very important to get to maintain it, to learn it all the time. When you go to your bedroom and you lay in your bed, that's actually a training site where you train your brain. As soon as you sleep and dream, especially, then you are having all kinds of images and triggers of emotions that make that you train your emotion regulation system. And that's mainly this link that's considered to be trained then. So better have enough sleep to do that. That's also one thing. But that's just modeled in this model. So we don't have only aesthetic network here, but we also have this adaptive situation of the network. And then for that, of course, for the connection from FS to CS, that's the state names here. And then you have this self model for heavy learning. So we just can apply heavy learning here as we saw before. So this is the same picture basically. And then we have the higher level for this is the metaplasticity. Metaplasticity, by the way, is in fact a form of control of the adaptation. So you can also say it's a kind of control level. So this is controlling the speed, and this is controlling the persistence. Hebbian learning, as we model it, usually has a kind of persistence factor in it, and that's just a number that indicates how much you lose over time, per time unit, or what part persists over time. If this persistence factor is 0.95, for example, then you states to control that, and that's then the second order self model. So this is just an example that's integrating many of the things that I mentioned before in one model, and this model even makes sense. This is a very this models processes that are very common, very important, even very relevant. But of course, in modeling sense, it's a bit simplified. What you often do in modeling, that you just abstract from a number of aspects. So that's the self model for stress plus adaptation and persistence modulation, two types of adaptation principles of the second order. And this is the first order model for the learning. And these are the descriptions of them. So that's an example. Now you can just run it. And here you see what happens, and then you get the graph out of it. This is just created by the software environment we have. You just add the network characteristics as input, and then it automatically gives you dynamic patterns as that you can just depict as graphs like this. So this is the stressful stimulus that is described here. Then we have this feeling. So the feeling is high. And the reason for that is that the regulation, the control state for regulation, is a bit low. So therefore, this feeling is not regulated well. Now, this is an example where we add the therapy state here. So that comes in at time 100. And then you see that now there is a boost of the control state for the regulation. And you see also that automatically the feeling state comes down. What is good, but of course this will stop immediately if you stop the therapy. So if there is no learning, the therapy doesn't even make sense because you become fully dependent on the therapy. You can never stop it anymore. So fortunately, there are ways out of that, and that's exactly what the plasticity is doing, and in this case also helped by metaplasticity. So that's another graph here, that there is a number of things that are described here. So this is the connection weight, the learning you can see from it. So it's, you see that the connection weight is low, very low. And then after this second phase with the therapy, you see that there is a boost of it. And it is low, let me see, because the learning rate, that's the second order state, H, is practically zero. Therefore, there is practically no learning here. But because of the going down of the stress level, the speed goes up of the learning, and therefore you have learning now. This is how it is described from neuroscience, how it can work. So then, especially this is based on the article of Kasia that I was mentioning, that you can find in the list. So then we have this boosted learning, and then there is also this persistence that's reduced, and it also goes up, which is also a healthy effect. And then finally, I should say here, you can see that now the therapy is stopping here, but now there is still the stress goes a bit up, but it still stays limited here. And also the control state, it gets its value there, it's higher. And that's because the learning has been successful. So therefore, the learning makes you independent of the therapy. So the therapy makes that you are able to learn, because the learning was blocked because of this adaptation principle. And then the learning is unlocked because of the therapy, and then you learn, and then because of that learning, you don't need the therapy anymore. So that's how it works. So this is just to give the inspiration. So now let's now see what can we do in social science areas. So there are some first order principles known, and they are like the bonding by homophily adaptation principles, that's sometimes called birds of a feather flock together. That means that if you are a bit similar, then you feel attracted more and then you get a stronger connection. But there are also other ones in the literature, like the more becomes more adaptation principle. If you already have a lot of connections, then you are a kind of popular person, and then you get more people that are attracted by you. This is also called preferential attachment in some cases. In other cases, it's called Matthew effect. And there's also a variant of Simon, like the rich become richer, something like that. So there are many variants of this principle. There is also a principle that says interaction connects. That means that if you prefer somebody to get some better connection to, better to plan activities together, then you learn to know the person better and the person knows you better, and perhaps that will lead to stronger connection. So that's the interaction connects principle. So let's concentrate. I use examples now from the bonding by homophily principle. So this birds of a feather flock together idea. That means that if you are more alike, then you develop stronger connections over time. The criterion here is similarity. How similar are you? For example, do you both like to watch Netflix series, or do you both like to have outdoor activities instead? So these types are of properties you can consider here. So in these cases, if you are both alike in those things, you may bond a bit stronger, make stronger connections. Normally in the literature, also in my own previous papers, it's applied to objective states for being similar. So you do prefer Netflix series, or you do prefer that, but they are not based on what other people think you have, you prefer. So those are just subtle differences, and perhaps in reality it's more what people think of each other than what they really are that makes whether or not they do the bonding. I will come to that in some more detail. So that makes the similarity becomes more based on subjective representation of each other. So this is the basic situation for bonding by homophily. Then these are the base level states, or they are the actual factual properties of the two persons, of X and Y. And then you have the bonding by some connection between them that gets stronger. Actually, you may recognize exactly the same picture as you have been learning, and that's true. This, from the connectivity point of view, they are exactly the same. That principle from neuroscience and this principle from social science, but not on the level of the combination function used here. That much specifies the precise adaptation principle. I will show that in a bit more detail here. Let me see. So that's again a connectivity self model here for a social network, you can say. So let me see this. This is a function. I do it now for the objective states, which have values V1 and V2, one for person X and V2 for person Y. And this is the function. I will try to explain why this function does make sense to a certain extent. So birds of a feather means that you have a high extent of similarity. And that means you can say the values between the two persons are not so different. So the level of preference for Netflix series is, for example, 0.8 and 0.9. And both are less than 0.15, which is a small number, so that they are a bit similar. That's the idea. And if you can rewrite this to this one, the subtraction of this, then this criterion is that this is positive. And you see that that part is there in the formula. So this part is here. So this means if this is positive, that means you're similar, given the tau criterion here, you can say, then this becomes a positive number, which is added to your current value. This is the current connection weight. And you add a positive number to it. And that means your connection is increasing, becoming stronger. And if this is even very low, 0, for example, then this is the highest number you can get here. Then it gets in a faster sense, stronger. If it's practically tau here, then it's very slow, of course. So that's a very important part. And then the flock together, that means that the connection becomes stronger and the W should increase. That's what I already show here, that when this positive it will increase, then you have this connection from that. By the way, this is only just to normalize the values that they stay between 0 and 1, that they stay in a 0-1 interval. They don't have a further role than that, other than that. So that's just, this is then again a specification of an adaptation principle, just a formula. That's all, a declarative formula. Instead of an algorithm or whatever you otherwise would describe, it's just a declarative way of specifying it in one line. So that's what is just used in the network model that you can design for that state, this the W state, and then it's run automatically by the generic computational network engine that is built in the environment. So all states are run by the same difference equation that's there. And this is the way how you give the information to the difference equation. So that's how it works. You separate the declarative part of the modeling from the procedural side of the process. And actually, some of you may have heard that earlier, like in knowledge-based systems or expert systems, that was also a kind of idea to separate these things. Also in logic programming, separate the logic from the procedural side. It's actually a reuse of a similar idea here. So now, further about the social networks. We have these three levels, at least that's what we would expect. We have the social network itself, the base level where you have the contagion, the social contagion, how people affect each other directly concerning their states, like the emotions or the belief states or information or whatever, opinions. You can have adaptation of the network, like the connections change, but maybe also other things change. And you can have control, at least if we take serious the lessons learned from neuroscience, you would also expect there would be some form of controlling of the adaptation in social network areas too. So that's an interesting question, because it's much harder, almost impossible, to find in the social science literature references like second order adaptivity, and certainly not metaplasticity. So you don't find concepts like that. In neuroscience, they develop these concepts, so that's very good. And we can use them then for our models. But what, as a modeler, can I do if you cannot find such principles in social science? The only thing you can do is make them up yourself. But I'm not really a social scientist, so I don't know whether that's the best way to do. So therefore, I would like to challenge people from social science to think more about such distinctions in conceptualizations. So let's at least still expect that such an architecture should be applicable in social science as well for social networks. And then I will just illustrate it for certain examples. Now, this is for the contagion, this is for the bonding then, and this is for the control of the bonding. So this is a base network. I just focus now on two persons that have related, that have contagion of their states mutually. But of course, in the network, you have many more of them. But for the moment, I leave them out of this picture. So that's the social contagion in both directions. And then you want to have the dynamic, the adaptive connection rates. So we have representation states for that. This is for the connection from A to B, this one. This is for the connection of B to A. So it was for the neuroscience context, we called it W. Now I call it a representation of W. But actually it can do the same. It represents this connection rate. Although it's the dynamics of it is defined in a different way, not according to the Hebbian learning, but according to the bonding by homophily. So the bonding by homophily uses now, in this case, the representations of your own states, of your own states and of the other person's states. So this is the representation of person B by person A. And this is the representation of the person A, him or herself, by A. So then these two are used to determine this connection rate. And according to the function that I just have shown, then this is say updated all the time. And then this is observation, you can say, you observe the other person. And there's also an influence from communication. The other person can tell you about it, and then you have communication. So there are two things here. And so then we have that. And then we have these subjective states formed about each other and about oneself. And they have their effect, the connection rates, the representation of that. Then we still want to have the control level. So let's assume that there is a control possible of the communication and of the observation. You control your own observation, you control your own communication. For example, you ask the other person, do you like Netflix series? Well, these are control states for that. And they, in this case, they simply are triggered by having your own representation, but you can do it in many different ways. And then these control states have their effect in the sense that they open up the channel. So the observation control state, the CO, opens up this channel from observation, that's user observation, and this one opens this channel for the communication. So that's how the control can work in this case. But as I said, this is just made up by me as a modeler, and I'm sure that social scientists can do much better than this. So I hope they can do it one day. And then I'm quite willing to use them, their principles to do the model, to make models of them. So that's the idea. Then we have at least an example of such a model where you have this control level as well. So this is there is a small example that I can show that is there are four persons, Mark and Jenny. They have a strong relationship. Mark and Dion have a strong relationship, and Jenny and Anne as well. And these are just weaker friendships. But then it turns out that Mark and Jenny both like the Netflix series very much. And the other two, Dion and Anne, they prefer the outdoor activities. And then if you have this process of bonding by homophily, you get a situation that these are the strong links after a while, and these are the weaker links. So that's what happens there. I have some graphs for that. Do I still have a bit of time, or should I try to come to an end now? Because that's also possible. So I have these graphs. I can show them. This is the liking of Netflix series that have some contagion effect. You can see some effects from each other. This is the not liking the Netflix series. And then the bonding, you see here the bonding of Mark and Jenny that were not, had no strong bond earlier. They become stronger. And also the other way around. And also for Anne and Dion, they both get stronger. And this, of course, downward effects, they are the breakups of the relationships that were there earlier. That happens as well. So this is how it works. The outcomes you see here. You can see the representation states here that happens. So these are the control states. For the observation, this is for communication. Then you get, after that, you get the representation formation because the observation and communication actually take place. Then you have these represented these representations about each other that are happening. Let me see. There is one variant of this that I also made, and that is bonding by faked homophily. You may remember or heard situations where you see somebody and you think, I would really like to have a better connection to that person. And then you know that person likes Netflix series, but you don't like them yourself. So what can you do then? Well, it's very tempting then to do as if you also like Netflix series, because maybe the other person will then use the bonding by homophily effect to get a stronger relation to you. Well, that is not seldomly applied in the reality, as you can imagine. And then you can also model it like this, because now we have a faked state. For example, every time that the other person visits you, you just occasionally have Netflix series on your screen of the TV. So then you just pretend if you just were watching that. Hopefully there will not no questions be asked about it. So then that's the basis for your bonding. You create, say, representation states for that. So that's the idea in that case. So then you still have, also in the communication side, you have the faked representation of yourself, and then you communicate that one. You also tell you like Netflix series, although you don't in reality. So the real state of yourself is this one, and the fake state is this one. So that you can also just model it like this, and then you get also an outcome. Let me see, I will keep this a bit short. It's just a variation of the other example. So the same type of model, but just with the fake states included. So this is similar to the other model. So you have still the same type of graphs. The bonding is still successful here. This is the state, the representations that are formed. This is the bonding that then happens. So this gives you an idea of how it can work. If you are interested to see more details, more than in these slides, you can always send me an email to ask about it. I have papers where these examples are really described in detail. So let's just come to an end. Well, the main thing of the discussion is that in neuroscience, which is a very strongly developing discipline, people have invented certain things like plasticity, a bit more recent years, metaplasticity, but it's still there. There's a lot of literature where you can refer to, and if you want to use it in computational models, you can at least have some justification of these principles. But in social science, it is not like that. The plasticity, there is something about that. So the adaptive social networks area, for example. But then on the place of metaplasticity, you don't find literature. Only very small number of them. If you find some of them, please send them to me, because I'm very interested if you can find something. So that's an open issue here. Where to find second order adaptation principles for social science? I have made myself now a number of models for that, but then I had to create my own second order adaptation principles. For example, another one for the bonding by homophily is, you remember this tipping point tau, that is a parameter of your function for the bonding. And you can have a second order adaptation principle where that also changes over time. For example, you can make it dependent on how many relations you already have. Maybe you already have too much, then you become very critical and you are less willing to bond. I have made such a model. It's one of the chapters in my 2020 book. That's also in the last slide in the references. So sometimes you can think of things that may make sense, but I would prefer that people from social science do that, and that they really come up with interesting things like the neuroscience people do. So that's my hope for the future. So from a wider perspective, the method of modeling, like self-modeling networks, is very interesting to model many different types of things and many domains, many disciplines. So that's you can see some of these things here, and this is already waiting to be exploited more than what is done now. And let me see. I emphasize again that it's still declarative way of modeling of very dynamic processes. It's not only just dynamics, it's also adaptive dynamics, but still modeled by a declarative way of, in a very concise manner, actually in one line specifications, where you don't need programming to specify it. And the characteristics, they are the main input for the simulation environment. And they, I have a standard format for them that's explained in detail in my book as well, my 2020 book, where you can just make these matrices, these tables, and these tables are just copied into your in the software environment, and then it can run automatically. This software environment can be just freely downloaded from the links I show in the next slide. And there are some, let me see. These are some further challenges. By the way, this is one reference as a kind of exception that I still want to mention. Kathleen Carley, she speaks about inhibiting adaptation for social networks, especially for the terrorist networks. So her claim is that terrorist networks needs to be very adaptive because they change all the time. So to be viable, this adaptation is a crucial factor. If you are able to inhibit in certain ways this adaptation capability, then you can say keep them limited. But so there is some literature about that. But you can also look in other areas like evolutionary biology, where there are many higher order adaptations described. Another challenge may be for some of you within machine learning, you could think of how can you use the standard methods described in machine learning to remodel it in this format, how far it's easy to do. So that's also a kind of challenge you can consider. Then that would mean that you get the conceptual core of a machine learning method expressed like such a combination function, while this all around things that define the whole algorithm are just left out. Okay, this is what I wanted to tell. Maybe there are still a few questions. This is the a list of certain references. So this is where you can find many publications. There is a YouTube channel about self-modeling networks. If you just type in self-modeling networks, you will find it. Oh, by the way, there is also a summer school which has a short course in all these concepts called Human AI with some subtitle. And you can find the software here, and there are small exercises to get familiar with the software there. And these are some of the main references. Okay, thanks for your attention. This was what I wanted to tell.